us can hear your roof. Your open hearts are enough compassion that those who are around you are strengthened for whatever it is they are carrying. And your open spirits are a gift to a world desperately in need of compassion. And as we gather together, we bring all of that, our God-given gifts, and we sift it through the love of the one who created us and who always is with us. And we become part of the shining light that is the wonder of the creative and providing love of God. Bless you in this time of worship. Bless you in the week that is to come. Bless you as you open yourselves to the presence of God and whatever it is in your hearts and on your minds and circling your spirits. Welcome to worship. We are called together because once there was someone who did such amazing things and said such amazing things that people often asked him,
"Who are you?"
"Who are you?" And sometimes he said,
"I am the light.
I am the light." The light of God is among us. Those who love the light,
follow the light.
Follow the light. Neighbors and friends, welcome home. Our opening piece this morning is Morning Has Broken. It's number 409 in Voices United. And the title comes from a little hamlet on the Isle of Mull in Scotland, a hamlet called Bunessan. And I have a friend who's an organist in the island of Mull, and she says, every time there's a funeral, they sing this tune with one set of words or another. So if you find your soul kind of lifting off into something Celtic, where it's windy and cold and there's heather and very few trees, that's why. 409.
Oh,
Holy One, we sing your song. We sing your song in places that are familiar and times that are circumscribed. We sing your song in unfamiliar places. A familiar song that brings us back to who we are and who you call us to be. We sing your song of mercy and compassion. We sing your song of grace. In the singing of these familiar things reminds us that you hold us always. The singing, the physical act, brings our body into it. The singing, the act of memory, activates our minds. And the singing, the act of prayer, joins our heart and our spirit in reverence. And in our hearts, our dear friends. This morning we pray for our friends on the Camino, Paul and Suzanne, just days from reaching the cathedral, the end of the journey. Bless them. We pray for the family of Irene Fowler. The beauty of the service yesterday commending her to you. The flowers that graced that time gracing this time. And we pray for Lori and Linda, her daughters, and those who have been closest to her through her 90 years of living. We pray for our friend Myrtle Thorsley, who died early this morning. Myrtle, whose laugh and whose lunching friends on Sundays brought such liveliness to who we are as your people. We know that you hold her well, and so we bring our blessings for her soul and for her family. We pray for Dave Carr's sailing friend, George Robert Jones, who was buried yesterday. May he and all who loved him know on this side and the other of death that you are always present to us. And Holy One, we pray for the children who are now settled into their schooling habits, for the professors who with pleasure or with a groan pick up the notes for class again tomorrow, for those who look after the buildings in which teaching and learning happen. We pray for those who are looking after our streets, trying to keep us safe and move us from one place to another. We pray for those who are sisters and brothers and siblings in faith. In the Christian faith, our cherished home, expressed in so many different ways, and in the faiths of people who have received goodness and guidance and wonder and true faith in so many ways. May their songs, familiar or unfamiliar to us, join with ours, so that on this beautiful morning, the pleasure of life, the privilege of knowing one another, the responsibility of making the world a better place, may all lift in our songs and in our blessings, for together, we are the people who live on this planet home. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. recognize the growing faith in the young ones, and understand with humility that our faith also is growing. We bring to you now our difficult times. The times when sometimes our only solace is to know that we are not alone. Your ancient people sat by the river in Babylon and dreamed of their homeland. And they wept, and they were asked to sing. And we know that when we are weeping, the song gets stuck in our throat. And so we bring you our tears. We pray for those who are in hospital and undergoing treatment. We pray for those who are frustrated trying to find work that is satisfying, that uses good gifts. We pray for those who are frustrated by neighbors and friends and family. We pray for those who are seeking reconciliation. We pray for those who are looking for honesty and are finding something pretty thin. We pray for all of us in our tears, for loneliness and grief. Or worry that something is about to happen, and the difficult nature of life when it does. All these prayers we bring you, all these prayers, for we know that at the very least, we are not alone. This is your world, and to you we belong. In Psalm 137, they hung up their harps on the willows because the tears came so strongly. But those harps came in, made the chord of love, and the chord of hope, and the chord of justice. And playing together, they brought a harmony that cheers the soul. May that harmony, that God-given harmony, hear your soul as you need it. Remind you that you are not alone. Amen. There is room for all. Number 62 in More Voices, the Choir Bell.
Luke 17, verses 5 through 10. The apostle said to the Lord, "Increase our faith." And the Lord replied, "If you have faith the size of a mustard seed, you could say this to the mulberry tree, 'Be uprooted and planted in the sea,' and it would obey you. Who among you would say to your slave who had just come in from plowing or tending sheep in the field, 'Come here at once and take your place at the table'? Would you rather not say to him, 'Prepare supper for me, put on your apron and serve me while I eat and drink? Later you may eat and drink.' Do you thank the slave for doing what was commanded? So you also, when you have done all that you were ordered to do, say, 'We are worthless slaves. We have done only what we ought to have done.'"
We wept when we remembered Zion. When we remembered the beauty of home, the wonder of the place we loved, the place where we could put down foot and recognize neighbor and be comforted and be fulfilled. fulfilled and be acknowledged. Where I come from, that often has a diminutive, not just because some of us are small of stature, but because we often have the same kinds of names. My heritage is Scottish, and where I grew up, people were Scottish, and they were Acadian, and they were Mi'kmaq. And for the Scottish ones, it would often be that the names of the father and the mother were visited upon the son and the daughter. And so you'd be young Johnny or little Donnie until you grew up and you were 85 years old and you were pretty close to 200 pounds, but you were still little Donnie. And that was a way, bless their hearts, of remembering the ancients and being remembered and being known. They remembered and they wept. In captivity in Babylon, made to work, made to be slaves. And they remembered the land of freedom that they hadn't ever cherished quite enough. The lenses of regret, the lenses of regret, often show a rainbow of promise in a place that is gone. I changed this sermon yesterday. I don't usually change sermons on a Saturday because I like to be better organized than that. But I changed this sermon because I love Psalm 137, and it is the bony M rendition that's usually in my head. Some of you may chuckle about that. This one was outstanding. Thank you. But I found myself yesterday weeping, and partly the words for Psalm 137 were in my mind, but I was distraught, and I'm going to tell you the story. It starts in 2010. When I was in Louisville, Kentucky, because I had been given $15,000 by a generous educational institute, the Louisville Institute, to study what it is people in the United Church of Canada say about God, how we talk about God, the language we use. And in a small group of recipients discussing how we would find markers for our programs and mark progress and connect with one another and encourage one another along in that, I sat beside the Reverend Michael W. Waters from Dallas, Texas. Now, I confessed to him, he is the founding pastor of the Joy Temple and one of the African Methodist Episcopal churches in Dallas. I confessed to him that I actually didn't know the music of Drake. He said, "You're a Canadian. You're young enough, you ought to know the music of Drake." He was studying the music of Drake, that rapping music, because he said, this is the first generation of African-American children who have not grown up on African-American spirituals and the gospel songs. He said it's the first generation of African-American children who have grown up outside the church. So what are they listening to and what does it mean? So they're listening to Drake. Well, that's interesting, and it's food for thought for us as well. What are our children in Edmonton listening to if they're not singing Psalm 137? The other day at South Terrace, we sang Jesus Loves Me, and there were people there who don't speak much, but they were singing along. One of the older ladies, as Eva Penzias Wright was playing, one of the older ladies was sitting at her table doing this. Clearly, she'd been a pianist. What are the songs our children will be singing? We need to listen to them. We need to know what they are. We need to talk with them about those songs. We need to be able to sing along. As we teach them our songs, we need to learn theirs. Michael Waters in Dallas, Texas, has been doing a lot of work with the Muslim leader there. Suleiman is the imam. They were recently in Toronto. He said, "I love your country. We were both warmly welcomed." I thought, good. And of course they were. A lot of Michael's work has to do with justice and reconciliation. And many of you have read a news story about a man named Botham Jean in Dallas, Texas, who was eating ice cream in his apartment. And Amber Geiger, an off-duty police officer, he's black, she's white, came into the apartment and shot him dead. She thought she was in her own apartment. It was the wrong apartment in the same building. And the case went to court this week, and she was convicted. She has a 10-year sentence, which is short for a murder sentence. The part of the story that you may be most aware of is that at the conclusion of the statement of conviction when the judge gave the sentence, the brother of Botham Jean, his name is Brent, asked the judge for permission to hug the woman who killed his brother. And that image went, as they say, viral. A concept of forgiveness. In a case where she did not say, I didn't do it. A clear case where she had shot and killed his brother and he asked to give her a hug. There was a clear demonstration of forgiveness. In talking about this, the Reverend Cornell Williams Brooke, who is a lawyer, teaches at the Kennedy School of Government at Harvard, and was also on staff at Harvard Divinity School, my alma mater, so he's a lawyer and a minister, he said this in response to an NPR question. What is forgiveness? Forgiveness means being open to the process of reconciliation. It's taking note of the wrong, but willing to be in relationship with the wrongdoer and opening your arms to the wrongdoer even as you acknowledge the wrong. My colleague and friend Michael Waters was in conversation with Cornell William Brooks, and together they were saying that forgiveness is not a gloss. And for any who have received the image of that young black man hugging that young white woman, we need to acknowledge that this doesn't mean it's over. That a reconciliation of forgiveness offered does not mean that there is also justice. It does not mean that the wrong is righted or that it is finished. That forgiveness is part of the journey. These are difficult things. It is very difficult to be a person of faith. It always has been. Look at those people hanging their harps on the willows by the waters in Babylon. It's always difficult to be a person of faith because there are always questions of forgiveness or sorrow or justice or wrong that confront us. We walk through a world where we know that much of what we do every day does damage to the environment, and yet we have very little choice. And so we make as many good choices as we can, but we know it is not easy. Part of what my colleague Michael Waters is saying is that the black forgiveness, the black gospel, the black presence on this continent is often set up as a moral hero, a bit of a spiritual fetish. Moral hero is my word, his word, moral hero, my word is spiritual fetish. That we can lean into that and say, if they can find the goodness of God, so can I. It must be all right, but it is not a-okay. Michael says we need not to look to the black community for moral heroes. We need to look for an ability to see one another as human beings. The reason I'm bringing you this story today is that yesterday afternoon, the neighbor who was the key witness in that shooting a young man by the name of Joshua Brown, also a black man, was shot and killed. And when I read that, I wrote to my friend Michael Waters and I said, I want you to know that we're praying for you. I want you to know that we share your humanity in this and that the difficulty of forgiveness is something I want you to keep talking about because I need to hear it. Because faith is hard. I'm going to tell you this. Michael has 2,000 followers on social media. He's one of the busiest African-American preachers in the south of the United States of America. Dallas is a big city with big problems. And he wrote me right back and he said, thank you. Thank you for your love and the support of the people around you. It means everything to us in order to do what we're doing. So I bring you that story. Because there's forgiveness and then there's justice. There's the acknowledgement that we are human beings, humans being. As our past moderator Stan Mackay said, humans being. And then there is the hard work of faith. Michael's other comment is that black forgiveness is weaponized against the community. Black forgiveness is weaponized against the community. Kind of like singing the blues, you know? There's so much bad news in it all, but if you set it to a tune that'll stick in the heart and move with you, then the song stays. And somehow you can move into the song if it's got some beauty in it. It's not so appalling, we're kind of compelled instead of repelled. Singing the blues or singing that song with that particular tune. It's the songs often that get us through. R.W. brought us a really difficult reading. All of you who signed up in the roster to read this fall, you had no idea, did you, that we were going to be reading the Gospel of Luke? Jennifer had a wild reading 2 weeks ago. Some soon had a reading last week that would just blow the top off your head. And fortunately, for me, it was Malcolm Sinclair preaching. He just blew the top off the church. And this week, R.W. brought us a reading about mustard seed. Well, okay, we can take that. Sounds like a bit of a morality story, but then it goes on. We don't talk about slaves anymore in a good way, do we? And here's Jesus talking about slaves. I'm just looking for the story again. I've got it right here, but I got so distracted telling you that other good story that I just lost my page. Here it is. Who among you would say to your slave who's just come into the field from plowing or tending sheep in the field, come in here at once and take your place at the table? Oh, my word, we're opening the table in a few minutes. This has great power. Who would say to the slave who's been doing your work, come on in and take your place? No, would you rather not say, make supper for me? Put on your apron and serve me while I eat and drink later. It's your turn to eat and drink. Do you thank your slave for doing what his job is, what he was commanded to do? And this is all our. So you also, when you've done all that you were ordered to do, you say, we are worthless slaves, we have only done what we ought to do. We are worthless slaves in a church, in a faith, in a gospel that talks about how we are the image of God, how we bring our goodness into the world. This is rough talk. Those who spend their time in the Gospel of Luke reminded me, these are the scholars, reminded me that it takes us to something that we're kind of not very good at in this generation. The builder generation was really good at duty. And this is really about duty. If you can sift away the slave metaphor, which fit 2,000 years ago, but it does not fit today, and we reflect on how recently there were slaves on this continent, it's appalling. And when we acknowledge that there were slaves who came with some of our forebears into Nova Scotia, into New Brunswick, into Ontario, and some of them came not just because they were free, but because they were still slaves, when we reflect on the slavery that is still present today, we grimace. But among the many points in this Lucan reading, for today, we can take the concept of duty that we're just doing what we're supposed to do. That as people of faith, we are simply doing what we are supposed to do. We're singing the songs of faith. We're listening to our children's songs. We're showing up at the legislature to rally for climate, against change and for the climate. We're stretching out and loving one another in so many ways, and because it's just what we're supposed to do. And that's the finishing point. That faith is hard work. It's not an easy gloss, it's not morality tales. Faith is hard work. And that's one of the reasons that our theme for this fall and this winter and this spring is, how then do we live? You find it at the top of the bulletin every Sunday. How then do we live when faith is such hard work? When we pray so hard for each other and show up for each other, and still we find the harps hung on the willows' branches because the tears have caught in the throat. And it's too hard for our neighbors and friends to see. doing it. We're seeking it first. It's the kingdom of God. And despite what we see in so many places, it's all around us. It starts at the table and it moves in the song. Seek ye first the kingdom. You'll find it in the hymn book at 356. We slow down to see the spiritual life around us, and we see reverence, wonder, and love. God Christ, one of us, yet also one of God, you call us in and you bring us to this sacrament. Through it, you release your energy to change the plight of people and circumstances. Destructive patterns of life are broken. New constructive ways of living together and sharing are established. God, we cherish the stories of our heritage, through which you call us to tend and keep this world, which is our home. We respond to the call to love our neighbors of every faith and nation, and to live with respect in creation. We see our united efforts, and we are grateful that it is good. And all of this requires more strength than we have, more vision than we can muster, more wisdom than we alone can share. Our ancestors in faith called on you when they needed strength, vision, and wisdom. Prophets, saints, martyrs, children, storytellers, grandparents, teachers, healers, they left a legacy. And you call all who follow Christ to share this bread and cup. It unifies us with all others who have shared this sacrament. It aligns us with all people in need. And it fills us with your holy presence. We see that it is good, for we are made in your image, and with grace we see in your eyes. And we proclaim the great mystery of our faith. We remember Christ's death, we celebrate his resurrection, and we wait in hope for his coming again. Send, O God, your Holy Spirit and on us and on these gifts, that gathered here out of love for you, we may know the presence of Christ and share it with your children of every age, race, orientation, geography, and faith. Through Christ, with Christ, and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory is yours, God, creator and provider, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you.
and sing the song of faith that encourages the world. Bringing courage, bringing justice, bringing forgiveness, bringing reconciliation, bringing compassion. Sing in our hearts the song of faith. In the name of the Christ. Amen. Tuma Mina, send me, Lord. Tuma Mina, number 572, in voice of Tuma Mina.
We'll do the verses as written. Send me, Jesus, lead me, Jesus, I will go, Lord. And then for our fourth verse, we'll add Tuma Mina, which is the name of the hymn tune at the bottom. It's the Kosa text. Say Tuma Mina. Somatla. So we say Tuma Mina, Tuma Mina, Tuma Mina, Tuma Mina, Somatla. And then we'll do an U verse, and then we'll do the first verse again, because it's only short. So send me, lead me, I will go. Tuma Mina, who's send me, Lord. And if you get confused, just listen to Jasper, because he'll lead you.
Who is with us as the Christ and who walks beside us as the Spirit. Amen.